name is Penny Russell, and I am a Wolf Trap Master Teaching Artist in Puppetry. And this is an engineering lesson. One, we have a problem. Two, we make a plan. Three, then we build it. Four, we test it. Well, did it work? Yes or no? Why not? Five, redesign, 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 redesign. Once we've learned the engineering method, we can use it to solve all sorts of problems in the classroom. This lesson builds up to an engineering problem by introducing some life science. We're gonna start meeting Mr. McGreeley. I purposefully chose a kind of puppet that I find in the classroom. They are not real easy to use and they're not that attractive, but they can still work in this lesson.
Oh, hello everyone, my name is Mr. McGreeley and I am a botanist. A botanist is a special kind of scientist who studies plants. But there once was a time long ago when I didn't know anything about plants and I wanted to create my first garden. Could you help me out? Okay, I've got everything I need. I've got my gardening shed and I have the soil. I have my soil. So, I am ready to plant a garden. What do I need to do first?
We'll ask the children for their ideas. He will follow them to the letter. Sometimes they'll suggest he water first because that's really exciting to them. Sometimes they'll suggest he get seeds but forget to put the seeds in the ground. He will do exactly what they tell him to do. It gives him a chance to really pull some vocabulary out of the children and pull on their prior knowledge about gardening and practice and experiment and fail until finally they get everything in the right order. So they tell him the first thing he should do is dig holes in the soil.
Okay, I've got my shovel right here,
and this is a stick with some duct tape on it. Very simple.
Digging, digging in my garden. Digging, digging in my garden.
He digs all of the holes. Next, they tell him that he should put the seeds in the hole. So we get some seeds. You'll notice that I'm not pretending he's based in reality. I'm not hiding behind the table. He is flying around. For this lesson, I've chosen just to make him a big personality and not worry so much about moving in a realistic way. He's gonna take the seeds out of his little seed pouch.
Planting, planting in my garden. Planting, planting in my garden. Planting, planting in my garden.
He's gonna close up the holes, make sure no birds or animals or wind take away the seeds. They're gonna tell him he should water and he has lots of options. He'll ask the children how they think he should water the garden. Often they'll say, get a bottle of water or a glass of water and bring it out to the garden. He'll do whatever they suggest. I have lots of different options here, but I made a hose just out of some pipe cleaner. He's gonna use that.
Water, water in my garden. Water, water in my garden.
So every time he tries to garden and fail, and even when he does everything correctly,
nothing.
Nothing happens. They'll realize there's something else these plants need. It's the sun. So he'll look in his garden shed. He doesn't see any sun. So he has to wait for the sun.
Sunshine, sunshine in my garden. Sunshine, sunshine in my garden.
Sometimes when the sun sets, he'll go to sleep. The next day he wakes up and still nothing. This might be the end of the lesson that day. We'll go back to free time and come back the next day to see if anything has happened in this garden. And probably nothing has happened. We're teaching them delayed gratification. We're teaching them that when they plant some real seeds, lots is happening, but they don't see it yet. They're gonna have to be very patient. So he gets a little frustrated and the children can help calm him down. But one day, finally, when they come back to the circle, something has happened. And I usually just do this right on the floor during circle time. He comes back and he sees something is growing.
What? He's so excited. What? Oh, thank you so much. He's giving the children all the credit. Thank you, thank you, thank you. You did such a wonderful job. I am so excited. He might even count how many things are growing in his garden. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5.
That was my voice, not his voice. But he's going to be very excited. He's going to want to let things grow a little more, so he's not going to pick anything yet. But that night, when the sun goes down and Mr. McGreeley is sleeping, something happens. You can take a really long time with this character. The children know exactly what's going to happen, and they are very excited. They might try to talk him out of it. He's really excited. In this version, I don't let him eat the carrots because it becomes a math problem. So Mr. McGreeley will come back. He'll notice what happened. He's very upset. What? Oh no! Oh no! Did you eat those carrots? The children will tell him exactly what happened. Oh, oh well, I hope it doesn't happen again. He'll go away. We're going to count these carrots, and we're going to use a little counting buddy here. We're going to count how many carrots are in the garden. Everyone count with me. 1, 2, 3, 4. We are going to count how many carrots the rabbit has. Everyone count with me. 1. We are going to count how many carrots all together. Count with me. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. At this point, you can guess what's going to happen. The next night, the rabbit comes back, takes just as much time, if not longer, takes another carrot. You can pull children up from the circle. Ask one children to count the carrots in the garden. Ask one children to count the carrots that the rabbit has. Ask one child to count how many carrots altogether. You're doing a lot of math. If they're young, you might leave it there. You might, if they're older, you might turn it into number sentences. If they're ready for subtraction, you might let that rabbit eat the carrots and you can turn this into a subtraction problem. So eventually, all of these carrots are out of the garden. If you're comparing sizes, you might have the first carrot be small and the carrots that get to grow a little longer get to be a little longer. Everyone can make their own counting bunny and count things all over the classroom. Well, here we get into our engineering problem. Poor Mr. McGreeley is so upset because those rabbits have taken all of his carrots. This is a problem. We're going to go back to that engineering song. 1, we have a problem. 2, we make a plan. 3, then we build it. 4, we test it. Well, did it work? Yes or no? Why not? 5, redesign, 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 redesign. Okay, what is our problem? Okay, yeah, I agree. Our problem is the rabbits are getting into the garden and taking the carrots away. We need a plan. So we'll ask everyone if they have a plan. Each child who has an idea will get to share it. If there's many children who have the same idea, we'll go with that idea or we'll talk about it a little more and agree on a plan. The first time I do this as a group, later we can divide into small groups and do more than one plan. The first time I did this lesson, the plan that they all agreed on and decided to do was to build a haunted house. It was not what I expected. So I went away that day. I came back the next day. They had built a haunted house out of blocks in the garden. They had painted and drawn pictures of ghosts and taped them inside. They also had filled the haunted house with wild animals from their block corner. So guess what? It worked. The rabbits did not want to come into the garden, but neither did Mr. McGreeley. So we did get a chance to redesign, 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 redesign. The next thing they chose was to build a fence around the garden. I came back the next day. They had chosen Legos as their material, and they built a fence. What they realized is this fence was not very tall, and they hadn't even completed it. It took such a long time to build a fence with such tiny pieces. So we had to redesign again. So our problem is the rabbits are getting into the garden. Our first plan to build a haunted house did not quite work. Our second plan to build a fence did not work with Legos, but we're not going to give up on that idea. We're just going to redesign the fence. So instead of using Legos, they chose bigger blocks. They are experienced builders now. They built a bigger fence with blocks. The other thing we realized, we had to discover how high that rabbit could jump. So we knew how high to build our fence. So we're gonna get the counting bunny back and we're gonna measure his jump. Sometimes I'll have a child stand and we'll mark how high this rabbit can jump on his leg. You can use a wall. I'm gonna use our garden shed today. So the rabbit will jump. We will mark his height with a piece of tape. And we will use non-traditional measurements to mark the height of that rabbit's jump. Oh, we're using Unifix cubes. We need a couple more to make it tall enough. We can make predictions about how many cubes we think will work. So we've made a measurement. The next thing that happened is the children built a fence this tall. But what happened is the rabbit could jump on top of the fence and into the garden. So we realized that whatever measurement we made, the fence had to be a little bit taller than the measurement we made. We finally solved the problem, built the fence, kept the rabbits out of their garden. Sometimes we build them their own garden next door. This lesson was inspired by Muncha 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 by Candace Fleming. Continuing on our engineering lesson, Mr. McGreeley has solved the problem of the rabbits getting into his garden. He's very happy, everything's going well, until one day he comes to his garden. What? He's very surprised. What? What is going on here? Oh, Mr. McGreeley, I am so sorry. Oh, hi, everyone. This is Dr. Lopez. Hi, everyone. My name is Dr. Lopez. I'm a zoologist. That's a special kind of scientist who studies animals. Every time she comes out, she will introduce herself that way. A little bit of a song and a little bit of rhythm on her science profession, and they will never forget it. By the third time she introduces herself, everyone says it with her. Oh, hi, everyone. My name is Dr. Lopez, and I'm a zoologist. A zoologist is a special kind of scientist who studies animals. She had a different name, but in my first residency with this story, the puppet we used from the classroom had Dr. Lopez written on the front of her, so she became Dr. Lopez. Mr. McGreeley, I am so sorry. Hi, I'm his neighbor, and I've been having a real problem next door at the zoo.
Oh, there's a zoo next door to me.
Yes, see, the animals are escaping their enclosures. It's terrible. I really need some engineers.
And this is my favorite part of any Wolf Trap residency I've ever done. All of the children in the class raise their hands really high and say, we're the engineers, we're the engineers. And she doesn't quite buy it. She said, no, I really need engineers. And they convince her, we are the engineers, we are engineers. And she says, no, see, I need someone who knows the engineering method.
And they start singing the song. One, we have a problem. Two, we make a plan. Three, then we build it. Four, we test it. Well, did it work? Yes or no, why not? Five, redesign. She's amazed.
You really are engineers. I said, we've been trying to tell you. So she hires them to fix the problems at the zoo.
Okay, thank you so much. Thank you, thank you, thank you. They've shared their results with her of how they worked with Mr. McGreeley and all the wonderful things they accomplished here in his garden. So she puts them to work with the elephant enclosure. And usually we start this all together as a group. We come up with a plan for the elephant enclosure. Later, we might divide into small groups and everyone gets their own animal to build. So because our problem was that the animals are escaping from their enclosure, they tend to build a fortress for this elephant. They have some prior knowledge about building. They don't start with the Legos. They know that will take forever. So they start with the big blocks and they build an enclosure that that elephant will never escape from. So you could end it there or you could keep going. Make it a little deeper lesson. So Dr. Lopez comes to see what happened. She decides to open the zoo, reopen the zoo, invites all the people back to the zoo. So the people are so excited that they get to go back to the zoo and see the animals, and they all come to look at the animals and they have some problems. They can't see any of the animals. They get very sad, where, and they go home. So we have a new problem. Our new problem is that the guests cannot see the animals. So we don't give up and we don't just cry, we make a plan. We have a problem, we're gonna make a plan. And this is child directed, so the teacher does not decide what this is going to be. In an engineering lesson, the children really have to direct the action. Sometimes they have built stairs for people to see the animals. Sometimes they give up on stairs and build a slope for the people to walk up. Sometimes they'll make windows. So lots of different ways of solving this problem. Often, they will solve this problem with maybe a ramp. So there's a ramp to get up and see the animals. So the people will climb up and they can look in and they can see the animals. We've solved our, oh no! We've solved our problem, but we've developed another one. Woo, 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 woo. This is not safe for people to be in the enclosure. So we're gonna put them in the ambulance and we're gonna take them to the hospital. And I have to tell you, by the end of some of these engineering lessons, this hospital is very, very full. But we're having a good time. We're failing and we're learning and we're redesigning. We're not starting from scratch. We're not gonna tear this down and start from scratch. We're gonna keep redesigning and make it better and better and better. Sometimes we get to a point where it's a safe enclosure and the people can see it, but the lesson could go deeper. The zoologist, Dr. Lopez, might come back and tell them more about elephants. Oh, hi everyone. My name is Dr. Lopez and I am a zoologist. That's a special kind of scientist who studies animals. Let me tell you something about elephants. They really like to be together with other elephants. They like to live in families. So the rules for zoos, they suggest you should have at least seven elephants, especially in an enclosure.
So we might have to extend our enclosure, make it big enough for seven elephants. She also could teach them a lot about elephants, or you could research online, or you could research at your libraries, find out all about your animals. Animals in zoos get bored, so they need novel objects. You can add that to your enclosure. They need levels. You could have levels in your enclosure. They are used to searching for food, so you might want to have places you can hide their food so they can search for food. They might need water in their enclosure. You can keep taking this as far as your children want to learn about that animal and about zoos. One of the children in my class was building an enclosure for a cheetah. He was very excited and he really loved cheetahs. So, excuse me, elephant. He built something for his cheetah. And he was very happy with it.
But he learned that cheetahs really like to run. So we decided to make this enclosure a little longer. I don't know how much running this cheetah was going to do in this enclosure, but he was learning empathy and really caring about his animal. He also learned that zoo animals need water in their enclosures, so we added some blue yarn to taped it to a block and gave him a water ball. So they're learning so much from this lesson. They're learning the problem solving, they're learning the engineering method, they're learning empathy for the animals, they're learning science facts, animal facts, they're learning to research, they're learning a lot with this one lesson. And you can take it as far as you want. Maybe you have animal enclosures all over the classroom and you need a path to go all the way around the enclosures so the people can visit. You might have water or a highway or rocks blocking the path. You might turn this into a bridge building lesson. You want to share the results. So Dr. Lopez will keep coming back and checking in and giving you advice for your zoo. But you also might bring another observer in and tell this observer all about your process and all about your zoo. And it might be another puppet that hasn't been part of this process. Tell them about your work here. You can invite the families or other classrooms in and share your results with them. So we've done the entire engineering method and we've learned a lot about the zoo. And I think that your zoo trip at the end of this school year will be a lot richer, a much richer experience than it has been in the past. Thanks.